Good afternoon, everyone. I gather I'm up against Andy Murray, who may or may not be beaten. I hope that I won't be beaten in this lecture. Although I must say, this has been one of the more difficult lectures to write. I think you'll discover as I carry on that it's quite an intricate subject. Anyway, thank you again for coming. This is the title of the lecture, and this is the not very helpful sort of set of subtitles, but that is more or less what I'm going to be talking about. Okay, so 10 seconds to commit that to memory. Okay, now, my last lecture ended with this slide of my signature, which you see here, and as you can see, it's not at all interesting. I've never been very pleased with this signature. It's not very particularly elegant, like this one. This is Christopher Columbus. I have just been around the world, but in every other respect, I'm not like Columbus. And it doesn't have the careless flourish of writers who are so important or so busy that they've reduced their lecture to a skeletal outline. This is a relative of mine who prefers to remain anonymous. In fact, I've always felt that this signature of mine that you've just seen is not really a signature. I don't actually sign my name, I just write it out, and that is something rather different. But apart from being a mild source of dissatisfaction to me, does that matter to anyone else that I write my name rather than sign a signature? You may think the answer is no, but I think you'd be wrong. Now, if I wanted to protect my signature as a trademark, I might find myself in some difficulty. I have this on the authority of Elvis Presley, or at least of a judge who adjudicated an appeal in 1997 that turned on the question of whether a commercial company's rendition of Elvis's signature could be protected as a trademark. Okay, this is the signature in question, and these are Elvis's own signatures, which have an interesting property, which I'm otherwise not going to talk about, which is that they vary over time. Okay, let me go back to that one, which is the one in question. At issue in this legal case was not whether the company's version of Elvis's signature was faithful to the original, but simply whether it was distinctive enough to be more than a writing out of Elvis's name. That's the point. I'm going to ignore the details of this case in favour of just focusing on the ruling by Mr. Justice Laddie, because it makes my argument more authoritatively. Always good to be able to appeal to the law. What makes signatures distinctive, Laddie said, is that they consist of a substantially unique and frequently highly distorted way of writing the author's name. They are, in a sense, a private graphic tied to one person. The signature mark in question is not a highly stylized writing of Elvis Presley's name. In fact, its most notable features are the words of the name itself. There is nothing graphically or visually distinctive about the style in which the words are written. It is just a simple, if not very fluent, cursive rendition of the name. So the bench, of course, gets to be quite rude in gentle ways. So here's the point. Although you may think that your name belongs to you, in English law, you do not own it. What you can own, or at least you can register for copyright protection, is your mark, a graphic device which may or may not be your name. What Mr. Justice Laddie has just told us is that to make a signed name into a protectably unique mark or graphic device, you've got to distort it, even to the point of illegibility. Recall how both Christopher Columbus and the writer of the second signature, my relative, how they did this in different ways. Maybe you can just go back. Okay, so you see he's made a kind of rebus of his name, Christophe Ferenz, and this little collection of letters up there, which apparently is... people have spent ages trying to figure out what they mean. Okay, this is the... Okay, then Presley we have again. Christopher Columbus and my relative both know how to make their signatures illegible in ways that I don't know. Apparently, even children understand the point better than I do, according to the handwriting expert Rosemary Sassoon. Sassoon studied how children learn the difference between writing their name and writing their signature. I was clearly asleep in that lesson at school. She found that for some children in the early stages of learning, as she says, quote, the perception of the signature seemed to be not so much a flourish, but a crossing out, a defacing of the name. In other words, deliberately rendering it illegible in the most literal way possible. And there you see kids who've written their name out and kids who've signed it. And you can see that they are versed in the higher levels of semiotics, unlike me. It's for this reason that one legal expert on the subject has asserted bluntly that, quote, the normal signature is an illegible signature. So that puts my defectively legible signature firmly in its place. It's not graphically or visually distinctive, in Laddie's words, nor is it even illegible. It is just, again to quote Justice Laddie, a not very fluent cursive rendition of my name. No wonder I'm not happy with it. Well, let me go on now to talk about the history of the signature. In a culture of literacy and documentation, we obviously need reliable ways to identify ourselves and to be identified by others in writing for legal purposes. For example, if we're acting as parties or witnesses to a charter, a contract, or a will. Signing one's name by hand on paper has become the authoritative convention for this, and one that's closely aligned with our own sense of identity. I mean, perhaps I'm too closely aligned with my sense of identity, which is why I have to write the damn thing out and never realised how I could kind of externalise myself into another kind of image. Anyway, much of the time, of course, our signatures are of no great importance. They appear on numerous trivial documents, such as private letters or application forms, no particular ceremony attached to them. But they become important in legal documents since, and again, I'm quoting a recent authority whom I'm going to refer to quite a lot in this lecture, Lorna Brazel, who's written the key study of the electronic signature, which I'm going to come onto in a moment. But anyway, Lorna Brazel says, by signing, the paper document becomes an original whose terms are enforceable against the signatories and therefore having tremendous evidential significance in civil law systems. It makes a document into usable evidence, in other words. It makes it probative. Signing your name is now such an automatic way of proving identity and validating or authenticating a document that it's easy to forget that these uses even have a history. But the autograph signature did not always enjoy this status as a mark of authentication and identity. In fact, it was something of a latecomer onto the documentary scene. In the rest of this lecture, I'm going to look more closely into the history of the autograph signature in law, its status, in other words, as a means of authorization and identification. Now, you think when you start looking into this history that it will be a pretty mundane story of the transition from impressed seal to handwritten signature as the accepted sign of identity and authentication, from sealing wax to ink, from parchment and vellum to paper, and so on. In fact, it turns out to be much more than this. It's a very intricate and complex story because tied up in the sign, and I think I've said enough to establish that it is a sign, it isn't just a writing of the name, tied up in it is a complex layering of historical processes at very different scales of eventuation or happening and of meaning. They include such varied considerations as the technologies of writing, the stabilisation of the personal name, the large-scale transition from an oral to a written culture in early medieval England, and I'm mainly talking about England here, but I'll signal when I'm talking about other countries. I spoke about some of these issues in other lectures. I talked about the name last week, and I talked a bit about the transition from oral to written culture in my first week. And indeed, also tied up in the signature, and this is a very intricate area which I can scarcely go into here, but there have been successive intellectual and indeed theological conventions for representing identity in a culturally persuasive way. It's very tied in with the history of concepts of representation and identity of the person, seen both theologically and legally. On the other hand, this intricacy doesn't seem to have provoked tremendous interest in the subject. The literature on the history of the signature is not huge. It's not lengthy. I ask myself, could this possibly be because the subject is actually either too arcane or just too boring to be worthy of extended consideration? And of course, today I hope I'm going to persuade you that it's neither too intricate nor too dull. Perhaps one reason that neither the character nor the history of the signature seems to have been of much interest to lawyers or historians is that in its standard form of the manuscript signature on paper, as I've already said, it seems self-evident. At the same time, a considerable body of case law has accumulated in this country to determine what constitutes a valid signature in particular cases. And I'll be returning to this in a moment. The law has, until recently, taken little interest in even defining the meaning of the term, far less in subjecting it to any historical analysis. And it's only since the 1990s that this absence of analytic attention gave way to a surge of active interest. And this was because of profound changes in the technology of signing that forced lawyers in Britain and across the world to take a new interest in what a signature is and what it does. This change was, of course, the advent of electronic documents dependent on remote electronic or digital signatures. And as you can see, I can only represent this by a path, okay, because there's no thing produced by the electronic signature. There's now a buoyant literature on this subject, emanating from the pens of lawyers, scholars in the fields of communications and IT, and in fact, there's even now a specialist periodical devoted to the subject called the Digital Evidence and Electronic Signature Law Review. It's a whole new area of law, in other words, the whole issue, not just the signature, but the status of electronic documents. Let me point to one of the major problems raised by electronic communication by citing the words of a recent scholar who writes, quote, although electronic signatures can perform all the functions currently required by case law and legislation, the thing to be signed, an electronic document, exists more as a matter of metaphysics than as a physical object. For this reason, it's very difficult for an electronic signature to meet any physical requirement of form. The problem here is that although, as we'll see in a moment, there's a good deal of latitude in what a valid signature looks like, the one indispensable characteristic it's had to possess, it has to look like something. It must physically add something to the document. The common law presumption is that this document, again, to quote Reed, the authority I just cited, this document would be anything upon which information could be visibly inscribed with recognisable and legible characters. And the further assumption, then, is that the signature will leave a physical mark or trace on its surface. But electronic documents do not satisfy this condition. And the signature, like any alteration to an electronic document, does not leave a trace. Or if it does, it's at such a microscopic level that in practice it's invisible. It's in little tiny weeny bits. There are probably people who know more about this than I do. It looks nothing like the marks that have been accepted in law as constituting a manuscript signature. Now, I'm not proposing to delve more deeply into the quite demanding issues raised by the status of electronic documents and electronic signatures. I won't have time to do that. Since the first decade of this century, most jurisdictions have enacted laws setting out the conditions for valid electronic communications and signatures. In Britain, this was done by the 2007 Electronic Communications Act. Attention has recently shifted to the need to standardise international practice and methods, notably throughout the EU. Harmonisation is made much more challenging by the fact that different jurisdictions have obviously developed different laws governing the formalities required for finalising documents. And that, of course, is another subject in itself, and I'll be touching a bit upon that later. But the debate about electronic signatures has focused a quite new level of attention on these basic questions of what a signature is and what it does. When I first started working on this, which is many years ago now, there was just nothing. I mean, there was a wonderful book in French, which I think I've put on my further reading list, and quite a lot of interesting work in French. The French are very, very good on the history of paper and writing. I think it has to do, as has become clear in the course of these lectures, with the very important place of paper and writing in French legal history. But elsewhere, there's a bit of German work, but there was nothing really seriously in English, no serious historical study. And the same, I may say, goes for the history of handwriting. Nobody has done a history of handwriting in this country to set against a very fine one that we have in for American history, which again is on the further reading. Okay, as I've already mentioned, English law has taken a very latitudinarian approach to the question of what a signature is. A definition of the term signature will not be found in England's Bible of Statutory Terminology and Meaning, the Interpretation Act of 1978, most recently reissued in 2005. That's the piece of legislation which tells you what everything means that you will find normally in a statute, and it has standard definitions, presumably for things like, you know, government, act, deed, whatever. Okay. Now, that on its own is not unusual. Very few countries have found it necessary to define in a statute or in a code what a signature is. If there are any lawyers here, I'd be curious about the next point, because it seems to me that Section 7.2 of the 1995 Requirements of Writing Scotland Act does amount to a definition of the signature. But why Scottish law now has this, while English law still doesn't, I do not pretend to know. I mean, it's an interesting subject, which I haven't had time to go into, even in my own research, but there is now a Requirements of Writing Act for Scotland, which is not paralleled by anything that I know of in English law. So in England, the definition of the signature has been left to the case law. One of the classic legal reference books, Stroud's Judicial Dictionary of Words and Phrases, has long taken its definition from an 1874 court case, R v Kent Justices, which has also become the de facto benchmark definition. And you'll find this scattered over the contemporary literature on signatures. That decision from 1874 reads as follows. A signature is the writing or otherwise affixing of a person's name or a mark representing his name by himself or by his authority with the intention of authenticating a document as being that of or binding on the person whose name or mark is so written or affixed. Now, you can see that this is a very capacious definition, which rather dismantles our common sense assumptions of what a signature is. It indicates that in terms of its form, my signature does not need to be my name, it doesn't need to be in my handwriting, it doesn't even need to be written or affixed by me in person. So what can a signature be? Well, let me count the ways, courtesy of a number of other standard legal reference books. All of the following have been judged as acceptable as valid signatures in 19th and 20th century English case law, and this mainly comes out of actions concerning wills, mandated by the 1837 Wills Act. The following are all acceptable. At different times, these decisions have been made. A typewritten name, a rubber stamp, a person's signature engraved onto a stamp and then applied by a third party in the presence of the person concerned. A surname, initials, a name written in pencil, a mark that doesn't include any part of the name, or part of the name only. And the case that is always cited for produced the judicial decision that part of the name did constitute a signature is the case of a woman who was unable to complete her will because she fell unconscious in the middle of writing it. An assumed name is also okay, a name which is not the person's real name but is intended to represent that name. A guided signature or mark, attend to this because if you're coming to the final lecture, it will play a part in that too. The cases of guided signature or mark involved in one case someone who was too ill to write, and in another, and this is a very famous one, an illiterate who held the top of a pen that was guided by another person to form his name. It had to leave a trace. You couldn't do what was called a dry ink signature. You couldn't just write or sort of trace the lines of a person's name without leaving a mark. But if somebody, a guided signature constitutes a signature, and we'll see why this is important next week. My favourite is that the words, your loving mother, constituted a signature, as long as she was also named in the document. Apparently, in some jurisdictions in the USA, a blood splotch will do the trick, but I don't really have full authority for that, don't have chapter and verse. So that's all quite entertaining, but the reason for this latitude is, I think, that in England, the courts have viewed the form of the signature as less important than its functions. In the words of one key court decision in 1855, signature does not necessarily mean writing a person's Christian and surname, but any mark which identifies it as the act of the party. That is simply a repetition of something I've said already. The primary function of a signature is to provide evidence of the will or intent of the signatory, and it's been defined by one legal authority as, quote, a mechanism to prevent the signatory repudiating his or her former position. A good reminder to us, I think. But in fact, this same authority, this is again Lorna Brazel, points out that, that the common law position vis-a-vis signatures derives largely, as I've said, from cases brought under the Wills Act, which aim to guarantee that a will genuinely represented the testator's wishes by fortifying it with numerous signatures and witnesses, precisely because when the relevant time came, the signatory, him or herself, would be in no position to confirm or repudiate their dispositions. And this is, by the way, this is the legislation under which the handwritten will became no longer, the holograph will, with unwitnessed holograph will, was ruled inadmissible in English law. The point at issue in the courts was not the grand question at this point of whether a will represented the testator's wishes, but whether he or she intended the mark in question to constitute his or her signature. Hence, to go on quoting Brazel again, English courts have, quote, been ready to accept as signatures marks which, had they stood alone as evidence of identity or intention to execute the document, might well have been inadequate, end of quote, but they were in practice accepted as long as there was enough circumstantial evidence of the testator's intent to sign. By contrast, I could allude to the situation in 19th century Germany, which is contemporaneous with most of the cases I've been talking about today, where an important case in the Supreme Commercial Court in 1877 found that an illegible signature was invalid without notarization. The court decision ran, "It is true that the writer had made an effort to write his name, but he had not been able to inscribe even a single recognizable letter on the note, but only pen strokes that bore no resemblance to letters of the alphabet," end of quote. No problem in England, but a problem in Germany. Okay, so although this is the main function of the signature, what I've just been describing to indicate will or intent, it's got other functions. Principally, to identify the signatory, to authenticate the content of the document, and to constitute a formal, quasi-ceremonial moment that makes the signatory aware of the significance of what they're consenting to. That is just by convention. There's no law that says it's got to be ceremonial. But the idea is that as your hand hovers over the page, when you're about to sign your will or sign some other frankly important thing, do I want to buy this house? Do I want to commit myself to this contract? The signature requirement gives you a moment to think, do I really want to do it? And once you've signed it, you do really want to do it. Or you have indicated that you really wanted to do it. Where there's a provision also, finally, that a document must be signed at its foot, as in the Wills Act, then the signature bolsters the integrity of the document by disallowing any additions appended below the signature. This final function of writing under is conveyed more explicitly in the English legal term subscription, which is almost, although not quite, a synonym for signature in certain circumstances. It's also seen in the normal German word for the term signature, Unterschrift, so underwriting, the same as subscription. By contrast, the English word signature derives from the term sign, and the same is true of the French word signature, and they derive from the Latin term signum or sign, a term which we're going to meet again shortly. So out of this list of the contemporary functions of the signature, I'm just going to select two in order to explore how they figured in the emergence of the modern signature. This is the significance of the act of signing and the signature as evidence of identity. And that's what the bulk of the rest of this lecture is about. Let me start with the significance of the act. To the extent that this can be treated as part of the character of the contemporary signature, we're entitled to see it, in other words, a slightly ceremonial act of signing, as a residue of pre- or non-documentary methods of giving certainty and publicity to an agreement or contract. In my first lecture, I referred to the path-breaking research of the historian Michael Clancy into the transition in early medieval England from a non-literate oral culture, in which memory was the repository of knowledge, to a literate culture in which this function was eventually taken over by writing. And I want to refer again to the example I mentioned in that lecture, an agreement for the transfer of property and land, which needed dependable validity that would outlast the life of the donor. Now, early medieval transactions of this kind were performed not primarily by the written agreement, but by what was called hearing and seeing the transfer, by oral declaration, and by the transfer of a symbolic object invested with authority and significance in the presence of witnesses. In land transfers, the land itself had to be delivered into possession of or seized by the recipient. Hence the ceremony of livery of season, which is mentioned on this image. Okay, if you read that, I used it a few weeks ago. This is a marker for the landing of William Penn in Pennsylvania. And it's a standard American historical marker, but it tells you what he did, okay? He performed livery of season, he took the key thereof, we did deliver unto him One turf with a twig upon it, a porringer with river water and soil, in part of all. In other words, those physical bits of the land, and the water in this case, it's on the Delaware, stood for the whole territory. Here's a description from a more recent authority, the barrister and land registrar, Charles Fortescue Brickdale, who was a late 19th century expert in this field. And he wrote, this is from the 1890s, I think. No, early 20th century, perhaps. A written document, he writes, usually formed part of this ceremony, but it was not absolutely necessary. The ceremony involved a symbolic act, more or less publicly performed, on the land itself, or at least in sight of it. The ceremony consisted in the vendor handing to the purchaser the ring or hasp of the door, or a branch or twig of a tree or a piece of turf, or even a parchment deed or gold ring, and pronouncing a set form of words such as, "Here I deliver you season and possession of this house in the name of all lands and tenements contained in this deed," and both parties holding the ring, hasp, branch, turf or twig, and the deed, if any. Here's a statue of William Penn, holding turf, twig and key. So this is, yes, actually, that's right, this is in Newcastle, Delaware, not actually what is now Pennsylvania. In the text of this lecture, which you can pick up after the lecture, I've included a link to a YouTube clip, which I couldn't show here because of copyright, I think, and where you can watch a Colorado attorney, Michael Robinson, performing the ceremony of livery of season in a TV studio for an information network called Broker IPTV. It is not the most exciting 3 minutes of television, but it's worth having a look at because the brokerage company, or the company that provides this service to brokerage, in other words, to real estate, to estate agents, is showing, you know, they have an information network, and the information clip in this particular case was, how do you do livery of season? So they actually perform the ceremony. Brickdale, the chap I've just quoted, was highly unsympathetic to the mentality that relied on this process, on exactly this livery of season. He described it as, quote, an elaborate and futile pantomime that needed, he quote, to carry on with his quote, to be put on a rational basis, making the written document supreme. In his view, it was only because, as he said, primitive man is very suspicious of writing, that the ceremonial act of livery of season had survived up to the mid-16th century. I suppose that the significance of the act of transfer persists in our term conveyance. But of course, in our more enlightened time, we're more ready to recognise that oral culture and the symbolic authority that attaches to material objects are not reducible to mere primitivism or superstition, but represent an equally rich and complex mental world that is just different from our own. And in any case, this preference for the authority of an oral account over a written record has a very ancient lineage. It's the argument that is famously put into the mouth of Socrates in Plato's Phaedrus, when Socrates, in a much-cited statement, privileges speech over writing, arguing that writing is an inhuman thing, it weakens your memory, it weakens human wisdom, and it's closed to dialectical disputation. You can interrogate a speaker, but the written text is mute. And that preference for the authenticity and authority of speech over writing has become a rather important part of certain debates in literary theory in recent years. Now, referring to Michael Clancy again, the historian of medieval England, he gives a wonderful example of the tension that could arise when cultures of speech and writing were in contention. This is the story that's told by the chronicler Eadma, if that's how you pronounce his name, of a dispute in 1101 between the King of England, Henry I, and the Archbishop of Canterbury, Anselm. In fact, Eadma was Anselm's biographer. And the Pope was also involved in this. The resolution of this dispute depended on the relative weight given to written papal letters that had been brought to England versus an earlier verbal message from the Pope that had been relayed by a deputation of bishops. Anselm's side argued for the authority to be accorded to what they called, quote, documents signed with the Pope's seal and not to the uncertainty of mere words. On the King's side, his partisans countered that they would much rather place their faith in the words of bishops than in what they dismissed as, quote, the skins of wethers blackened with ink and weighted with a little lump of lead, end of quote. Now, that contemptuous, that dismissive phrase is, of course, it's a description of a parchment document authenticated with the papal seal. I suppose I should have had a version of it here, but it was a special kind of seal known as a bulla that was appended to the end of a papal document. The king's partisans reduced the pope's letter, as Clancy says, to a mere physical object whose content disappeared behind its materiality. But in early medieval Europe, or in England and in Europe generally, at least early on, even the literate were more used to hearing and seeing than reading. And their view of the relationship between writing and reading was in any case not the same as ours. I don't know if any people here have come to Belinda Jack's lectures on reading and writing. I'm sure she's talked about this question of changes in the practice and understanding of reading and writing. In this medieval oral culture, reading was authoritative not for its fidelity to a text, but for the fact of its orality and audibility. In the example I have just used of the ceremony of season, it didn't matter so much whether it was accompanied by written text or not, and that was what Brickdale's point was. It may or may not have a document attached to it. It was the oral declaration and the performance in the presence of a whole group of witnesses that counted. The written charter, meanwhile, was as much a symbol as a text, and it secured its authority often by means of its visual artistry and impact. It, too, was something to be seen rather than read. It was partly for this reason that medieval charters were often festooned with multiple seals and flourishes. OK, it's not a brilliant example, actually, but you can see lots of seals. This is a charter of Richard III. I confess in an act of great humility, for which I'll have to do contrition, that I'm not sure what this charter does. OK, but anyway, you've got a lot of seals and you've got some signatures there, too. There are fewer flourishes than I would have liked, but we'll get one in a moment. Now, obviously, the written document brought enormous dividends in terms of communicative reach and durability, but the culture as a whole first had to overcome their belief that speech was more authoritative and reliable as a medium of communication than writing was. People had to understand the document as itself constituting a contract, rather than merely serving as a record of something that had been performed primarily by speech and act, and that if necessary, could be verified by calling on the verbal testimony of the witness's name. The reason you wrote the names of the witnesses down was that later on, if someone said, this land is not your land, you could say, no, we're going to get, you know, Walter and John and whoever to come and tell us that they were there, when, as the document tells us, they were there, they saw this happening, they saw the ceremony taking place. To overcome the authority of witnesses who could be orally heard in court, people had to transfer their faith from living witnesses to a mute and passive document, the kind of thing that Plato and Socrates were so disparaging about. In other words, they had to substitute literary proof for testimonial proof. This meant providing a reliable and accepted means of signifying the presence, identity, and consent of the parties and witnesses to a transaction in the written document itself. And so I'll move now to the second function of the signature, which is to provide evidence of identity. In early medieval continental Europe and England, the handwritten signature did not perform this function. Although the late Roman Empire had adopted the signature as a token of validation for documents other than the sealed will, it was the Roman seal or signet that was handed down to the largely literate societies that followed the collapse of Rome. And that's very important because you've got to remember that there's a spell of general illiteracy following the collapse of Roman jurisdiction. Writing is lost, okay? And it's only gradually that the Anglo-Saxons can write and the Merovingians and Carolingians in France are the dynasty, the political authority, which starts to reinstate writing. But that means that for several hundred years, writing is not... I mean, it's very, very localised, okay? It's localised mainly in the institutions of the church, the bishoprics. So in medieval Christendom, the cross or signum was the privileged sign, both on signets and in writing. A Christian illiterate would mark a cross on a document and fortify this with the conventional process of signing the cross on his body. A literate participant could then act as the witness of this marking of the cross and write in the words signum de, whoever it is, let's say Walter, signum de Walter, as well as his own name. So that's how you authenticate these early documents. The X, therefore, was not simply a convenience for an illiterate, but a sign of great religious significance that belonged with the performative repertoire that I've been describing. It was very much like the performance of Livery of Season, that when you're writing an X on a document, it's not just because you're not writing your name, but you're investing that document and your act with the significance that attaches to the cross in Christian symbolism. Later conventions and terminology must surely bear witness to these older practices. The continuing currency of the alphabetic X to denote same name and signature derives from this usage. It's not alphabetic, it's actually symbolic. The word signature itself, as I've already indicated, arrives via the term signum and its derivation sign manual or autograph signature. That's how it gets into our language. The seal was, in a sense, intermediate between a symbolic object and a signature. And that's why, in some respects, the semiotics of this are very hard to pull out. The sort of the representational and symbolic meaning of these things are hard, because the seal is partly signature and partly... It's like in a sense, an unwritten signature. And it's also intermediate between the literate and non-literate worlds. I'm going to put up the next slide. This is just a very standard English seal. Something has dropped, but it doesn't matter. You can still hear me. Can you still hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, those who could hear me, can you still hear me? Okay, so Clanchy calls the seal the harbinger of literacy. As it developed, and as you can see here, it's a portable token whose design incorporated both a pictorial symbol, there's something just about visible in the centre there, which might be suitable to the owner's rank or occupation, and either his name or her name, or a motto or rebus gesturing to the name. It was used to make an impression on a wax or metal blob that was attached to the foot of the document in question, or that could literally seal a confidential document, such as a will or a letter. The earliest medieval seals, and again, I perhaps should have given you some examples of the much more elaborate seals that were the first seals to be used in medieval Christendom. They were initially the monopoly of ecclesiastics and royalty, but their use expanded to aristocrats and public corporations, such as cities, as political and administrative authority disseminated. So you can see behind what I'm talking are huge shifts in the nature and distribution of political authority in medieval Europe. Seals of this kind, these grand seals owned by municipal corporations or by bishops or by aristocrats, carried such authority that their use was also made available to lesser people, who thereby borrowed for their own documents the power of guarantee that they conveyed. So you didn't have to use your own seal. You could go and ask your local bishop. By 1300 or so in England, the possession of a personal seal, however, of this kind, appears to have become routine. In a society where few could write, but written documentation was expanding, and this is well into the period where writing and written documentation was claiming authority, okay? The wax impression of a seal was functionally equivalent to the modern signature, so that documents that did not carry seals were regarded as suspect and unreliable. Now, the fact that seals were so prevalent in England may have helped to hold back the acceptance of the autograph signature by name in this country until the late 14th and 15th centuries. I think this is later than other countries. Thereafter, however, the seal and signature coexisted for several centuries. The signature's achievement of primacy was contingent on the spread not so much of literacy, and I think this is a very common misconception that you can measure literacy by seeing who signs their name on a document. That is not evidence of literacy. It is evidence that somebody's been taught to write their name, but it's no evidence that they can write anything else or read anything else. And there's been some very interesting work in French history to debunk the idea that the... signing, being able to sign your name, is any proof of literacy whatsoever. So the achievement of primacy by the signature is a function of complex cultural transformations which brought with them familiarity with and confidence in writing and the written. So it's that grand transition from the oral to the written, which is a very, it takes many shapes. It's a huge cultural process, and it's important in its time as the arrival of electronic communication in our time. Also important here, of course, was the stabilisation of the personal name, which, as we saw last week, had gathered momentum in England by the mid-14th century. If we look briefly for a moment at southern Europe, by contrast, the revival of Roman law in the 12th century had already recovered the signature as an alternative means of authentication. So if you're doing an international history, you get a different history for England than you do for parts of southern Europe. The alternative means of authentication in post-Roman southern Europe was in the form of the handwritten subscription and signature by an authorised notary. Okay, very, very important, the notary. The subscription certified the identity of its parties and witnesses, while the authenticity of the document was guaranteed by the notary's own autographed signature, often incorporating an elaborate paraph or flourish, which was recorded in an official register that enabled the verification of subsequent inscriptions against this original. Because, of course, you know, just as to remind, I'm sure you don't need reminding this, of this, the written culture precedes printed culture. So virtually all these documents are written by hand, and so the authenticity of the handwritten document has also got to be certified. Okay, so there are kind of layers of certification here. In a notarial culture, such as developed and flourished in France and Germany, but was very limited in this country, this is what constitutes the origins of that notarial culture, which we have vestiges of with our notaries public in this country, but they're much less important than notaries in other countries. And in this notarial culture, the documents themselves were dated and registered too. And so the signed and notarized document became and has remained the gold standard of proof in continental European jurisdictions. By contrast, English common law remained, broadly speaking, more open to the probative value of witness testimony and to cross-examination. That's remained. I mean, I don't know. I can't account for this difference. I haven't been able to. It's as I've said. It's a something that extends across a big cultural field, and you'd have to have more skill, I think, in comparative legal and cultural history than I can muster. But I, you know, if I think back to the way that common law works, the importance of the jury, the importance of institutions like Frank Pledge, which is a witness testifying to and standing surety for people, it has to be tied up with that involvement of ordinary people in the law in England so that it remained somewhat more distributed among ordinary people, whereas in these southern European cultures, these functions were drawn towards professional lawyers and notaries. At any rate, it was the continuing role that was played by oral evidence in English courts that lay behind a decision in 1677 in this country to enforce a statutory requirement of writing and signature for certain more weighty transactions involving real estate, property and wills, which might be subject to contestation in court. And that is this document, the Statute of Frauds. This statute, passed in 1677, followed the years of upheaval in the mid-17th century with the English Civil War and the Restoration and so on, which evidently generated numerous fraudulent claims and insecure transactions, which therefore prompted a quest for improved methods for the authentication and verification of contracts. The primacy of the signature under this Act was slowly affirmed by subsequent cases which make interesting reading. Well, I find them interesting, at any rate. I think it's because I'm not a lawyer, and therefore I find the way that the law attempts to grab hold of this stuff and make it work is just endlessly fascinating, because they're dealing with inherently such unstable elements, such as identity, such as language. Okay. The view that seal and signature could be treated as equivalent evidence of intent was proposed by the court in a case a few years later, in 1681, involving a handwritten will that was sealed but not signed. One of the judges in this case, this is Lemaine v. Stanley, which again is commonly cited in these circumstances, commented that, quote, "the putting of his seal had of itself been a sufficient signing within the statute, for signum is no more than a mark, and sealing is a sufficient mark than this is his will." Okay, so here are all those terms in kind of in play, like orbiting around the main question of whether this is authenticated. However, by the 1750s, this view had changed, with Lord Hardwicke arguing in a similar case that in Another case that involved a will, Hardwick argued the following, quote, "The statute requiring the will to be signed undoubtedly meant some evidence to arise from the handwriting. Then how can it be said that putting a seal to it would be a sufficient signing?" And this is the point. "For anyone may put a seal. No particular evidence arises from that seal. Common seals are all alike, and one man's may be like another's." Okay, so I come to the last part of this. I want to say a little bit about questionable writing. Although we've seen that in this country, neither your handwriting nor your name are indispensable for a valid signature, I want to end with a few observations prompted by Hardwick's implication that I've just quoted, that the advantage of the signature over the seal is that one man's handwriting is not like another's. If this is admitted, it ought, in theory, to be possible to verify the authenticity of a signature or of any other handwriting, or alternatively to expose it as a forgery. And in fact, how authentic and forged handwriting can be detected and proven in court has a long history, which is it's tied in to the changing cultures of writing and the changing context within which writing has circulated. In Europe, three legal tests of contested handwriting have tended to be eyewitness, familiarity, and expertise. In other words, the testimony of somebody who witnessed the questionable writing, okay, or secondly, the opinion of somebody who already knew the handwriting of the person in question, or C, the opinion of an expert in the techniques of handwriting who had the ability to compare multiple specimens. These are all three ways of, if you like, each of them a way of proving authenticity or forgery. Roman law, for example, knew the practice known as comparatio literarum, the comparison of handwriting by experts known as comparatores. And this was adopted in medieval and early English canon law. In early 18th century England, verifying a hand or exposing forged handwriting within In 18th century England, verifying a hand or exposing forged writing within the 18th century's small networks of commercial relationships was likely to depend upon the evidence of witnesses who were personally familiar with the hand of the writer in question. So you could call on someone to come and say, "Is this Joe Bloggs's handwriting?" And his friend would say, "Yes" or "No." By contrast, as you move further into the 18th century, towards the end of the 18th century, in the much larger and more anonymised paper commerce of the late 18th century and later, the detection and identification of forged handwriting were no longer left to friends and business acquaintances. Instead, in the words of one historian who's written a very interesting article on this, this was, quote, "underwritten by the authority of books, clerks, and specialised knowledge, and by the increasing authority accorded by the courts to written evidence in general." And you can see the 1837 Wills Act, which I mentioned already a couple of times, as a culmination of that. And we can have another example of the detection of forged handwriting from the notarial culture of early modern France. And there, following a notorious forgery of Charles IX's signature by his secretary, do not put your trust in secretaries, a professional corporation was chartered in 1570 as the Maître Juré Écrivain Expert, Vérificateur en Écriture et Signature, Compte et Calcul Contesté en Justice. In other words, a body, a corporation of Maître Juré, so sworn masters of expert writers who were verifiers of, or expert at verifying writing and signatures, additions and calculations when contested at law. These trained and examined specialists in handwriting guarded their expertise closely. In the course of the 17th century, they were given a formal role to present evidence in court proceedings, and they survived until the French Revolution, although they didn't exactly have a monopoly, and there was not a huge amount of either public or legal faith in their skills, partly, no doubt, because they wouldn't tell anyone what the secret of their abilities were. So if they said, "You've just got to believe us, we're expert, we know how to do it, but by the way, we're not going to tell you the secrets of our trade," people were entitled to say, "Well, huh, I don't put much faith in that." But in the course of the 19th century, as police and detective forces became normative and institutionalised in Europe, handwriting expertise, the ability to read a hand in this expert way, was incorporated into police science and forensic procedure in most European countries, if not without difficulties. This is one of the major German authorities from the early 20th century, Hans Schneikert. The difficulty was that handwriting experts continued to face popular and legal suspicion that it did not, in fact, take any special expertise to detect whether or not two specimens of handwriting came from the same hand. The argument was that anybody who was sufficiently attentive could do this. Anyone could spot this, the difference between two hands, okay? And in England, in the 19th century, the whole way the courts operated was that judges would not take testimony on subjects that they felt that the court itself, including the jury, could make a decision of. And so they were very dismissive of expert evidence on handwriting for a long time, till the 1850s. Handwriting, I mean, this is, I'm afraid I have not had time to go, this is really, of course, very interesting, the history of handwriting expertise, and I've had to compress it to these last few remarks. And so also is the other area which made the work of handwriting expertise difficult, and that was the simultaneous pressure to defend the boundaries of what they called a scientific expertise against the emergence and energetic popularization of a more ambitious science of graphology. Okay, reading character through handwriting. Okay, this is the grandfather of, there are earlier versions of this, but he's the Michon, his as you can see, system of graphology, the art of knowing people by their language, by their writing. Okay, and these are some of the people who popularized this. Enormously popular field, and it still is actually, less in this country, but if you go to France, Italy, Germany, you'll always find stuff on graphology in the psychology section. I like this little image here of the two guys. Okay, so graphology, and of course there's a whole area in which graphology is tied up with the emerging sciences of psychology. And what it meant to be able to read a character. But the graphologists basically say, show me a sample of handwriting and I'll tell you what kind of a person this is. They argued, in other words, these people, that handwriting was one of the best sources for knowledge of an individual's mentality and character because it's a process of involuntary movements. Okay, handwriting is not, it's involuntary, it's not done determinedly. And in that sense, it's very similar to the handwriting experts who would say, the authentic person signs their signature just as an act of automatic writing, but the person who's got to forge it has got to try to copy it, and that they can detect the difference between the signature, the piece of writing which is just, tossed off, so to speak, and the one which is carefully copied. And in fact, they would often say that the sign of a forged signature was that it too closely resembled an original. Okay, look too much like it. I mean, tied up in this, of course, is all kinds of interesting things about meaning and representation. Okay, so to put it in a nutshell, the graphologists claim that handwriting analysis enabled them to determine the psychological subjectivity and identity of the writer, while handwriting experts argued that their skill was directed at the more exacting, objective task of detecting the identity, or other words, of one piece of writing. It's writer versus writing. Well, there's much more that could be said about the relationship and overlap between these two fields of knowledge, handwriting expertise and graphology. They recall, I think, my starting point in this lecture series, which is the coexistence of subjective and objective dimensions of identity, separable in theory and yet here entangled in the word hand, which denotes simultaneously part of our physical body that is most involved in the act of writing, the act of writing itself, and then also its results on paper. The term is applied to all of those. All this is involved in the act of writing our signature. And to complicate it a little further and offer a preparatory glimpse of next week's lecture, my final lecture, let me show you this image. And this is from 1840, but I will quote the Reverend Samuel Morrison, a missionary in New Zealand a little earlier in 1815, who described this kind of act in the following words. The chief, the Maori chief, has signed the grant in a manner extremely original. He has displayed the ingenuity, which is a characteristic of his countrymen, in a minute and laborious copy of the tattoo marks upon his own face. Thank you.